up and down the coast, you know, and then we just kind of like drifted away into oblivion.
How, I mean, it was, it's not, I mean, when you're in that situation and you have somebody who believes in you and picks you up, the label, which isn't real easy to do.
No.
And I'm guessing at that time there was a ton of noise in LA, right? Like, yeah. I mean, there's a bunch of bands.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, being in that position where you have something that you feel like is really great and it's resonating with people and one of your songs goes to number three on the West Coast and you're like, it's going well. It's gotta be hard to say no to a label though. Right. I mean, like, what's that experience like? What did you guys think it was the right move at the time? Was, did it sound like
we were young and stupid and we were kind of like, you know, we were very idealistic and we thought everybody knew better than us. And we didn't, I think our instincts were to just do what we did.
Yeah.
But we listened, you know, and sure. we started dressing differently and, you know, cause we were like jeans and t-shirt. We were ourselves, you know, we were just doing us.
Yeah.
And it was a great band when we did that. And, it just kind of ruined us, you know.
And did you write all that music as well?
Yeah, that was all stuff I wrote.
Is any of that music still circulating these
days?
You
know, it's really funny because, the guy from the label a few years ago said, you know, I'm shutting down the label. I've got all your CDs. Give me your address. I'm going to send them to you. And I got a box with like, this was a few years back.
Did he release the rights to you too?
No, he still owns some of the publishing, but he sent me like 300-400 CDs. Yeah. And they were funny. They, some of them said had the Tower Records label on them and stuff. And they were just CDs that had come back from the record stores. And,
yeah.
And I started giving them away around here, and there's people around here who love that CD.
Rocking Gifthorse.
Yeah.
In Southern Oregon.
Recently, I was like, why isn't this stuff on Spotify? And so I'm actually trying to get this, I'm trying to get this stuff on Spotify because I think people dig it, you know. And it is, it turns out somehow it is on Spotify, but there's no metadata, so it doesn't have any names attached to it.
Oh, okay.
It's impossible to find, so I'm working on that.
Out of business,
I guess. I don't even know if they put it on or if I started to put it on one day and then forgot because I'm busy. But
yeah,
hopefully that CD is going to be available.
That's awesome. That's
some of the best stuff I've ever written.
Yeah. Have you considered bringing some of those songs out? Like,
I do.
You have, so you play some of the songs even today?
I play a lot of the songs today.
Oh, awesome.
Or, you know, 4, 5, 6 of those songs I play today.
Oh, awesome.
Still.
Okay, great.
Yeah, they're good songs.
Will we get to hear some of those this Friday?
Yes, absolutely. Nice. Yeah, there'll be 2 or 3 of them for sure.
Okay, and yeah, just if you're listening to this when it's released, then this Friday, the what is it, the 11th? Yeah, June 11th. We have Livve from the Hivve. We've got Bret Levick on our stage at 8 p.m. So tune in. It's going to be amazing. If you live in the area and you might be able to get a ticket, there's a couple left. You may want to jump on that as well. So anyways, I'm super excited, and we'll get to hear some of those tunes. From
it
Gifthorse.
Should be super fun. And I'm bringing – I have a band here called Left, and instead of a guitar player, we have a lap steel / dobro player. So we're kind of doing like Americana versions of all the tunes I've written for TV and a lot of the Gifthorse stuff. And I'm bringing my friend Bob Evanuk, who's an amazing dobro player and singer, and we're gonna rock some of the Gifthorse stuff.
That's gonna be an experience.
It's gonna be fun.
I'm so excited.
Yeah.
So okay, so let's go back. We were in 98.
Yeah.
And Gifthorse had its run. It was amazing, had its peak, and then made some choices and was given bad advice and followed it. And then where'd we end up?
So what happened after that was the guy from the label, after we kind of broke up, was going to finance a solo album that I was going to do. And so he gave me a certain amount of cash. I don't remember how much it was. And he said, make a record. And at that point, people were starting to record their own stuff, you know.
Sure.
And just, so yeah. I made a decision to, instead of going to spend that at a studio, to buy, you know, a Mac and an interface and some gear and try to learn how to self-produce. And I locked myself in a room for about a year, worked on 3 songs in that whole year. And that's where the career that I have now started, basically.
That was your first producing?
Yeah, the album never came out, but I learned how to produce. And that was before YouTube. Like, now you can go on and anything you want to know is on YouTube.
Yeah.
Back then, you're just trying shit, you know.
Yeah, yeah, you gotta learn, yeah.
Yeah, wow. So I worked for a year on 3 songs. One of them was a song called Killing Time. And they were kind of deep. They were like, I guess think Beck, you know, there's a lot going on. They were half kind of DJ hybrid rock DJ-ish kind of songs. Pretty funky, you know.
Yeah.
But I learned a lot, you know. It was what allowed me to, you know, Livve for decades after.
Okay, so you record these 3 songs. They never get released, but you pivot from that. When did you start doing, you know, when did some of your stuff start getting picked up for things like commercials and TV shows and stuff?
That's when that happened. So what happened is,
Cause that career took off. It seems like,
right? Yeah, that career I got in right at the right moment. There were not a whole lot of people who could do, believable guitar music in a home studio back then, like a rock, the sound like a rock band.
Okay.
And my partner from Gifthorse and I, for a while had kind of had that market cornered. And I re-met an old friend who was working at this company called APM, which is an umbrella company for Sony and EMI and all these places all over the world that license music to TV. And he said, hey, do you want to take a crack at it? And hooked me up with some people. And me and my partner did our first, you know, CD for that, for licensing. And that was...
So you put together a specific CD with licensable music, and then that just goes out to different...
Yeah, that goes into a database. And a lot of the production companies... and music supervisors have an account with APM where they can look for keywords and go through and find stuff. And that worked out really well. So we just started doing more and more of it. And this was right before I moved to Oregon. I moved here in 2004. We'd been doing that for like a year. And then I moved to Grants Pass because my wife's mom lived here.
Okay.
And
you had to get out of the city. You just had,
my daughter was going into first grade and the only good school we could find was going to be like an hour and a half away. And it was just starting to look like too hard.
Did you feel like at this point your career was more portable?
It was,
because you were recording in your own studio. You could do that from anywhere.
It didn't matter. Yeah.
Awesome.
And I kind of didn't really have like rock star aspirations anymore by then. I was kind of over that. I just wanted to make a living doing the only thing I'm good at, you know, or know how to do. So, so we moved here. And then between like 2004 and 2008, I had 2 partners, my guitar player from Gifthorse, and then this other guy, and we cranked out 300 tunes in like 3-4 years.
Wow.
That went out for licensing, and we did pretty well with those.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to list a couple of things here because it's pretty wild. So like, what was your first big gig or the first big pickup, right? So I imagine that was an amazing moment.
Oh yeah, hearing yourself on TV for the first time.
Yeah.
I don't even remember. One of the ones I remember was, I have this song Look At You that we still do that wound up on a big Discovery Channel, ad.
Okay.
That was running over and over. And then I had this other song called Date with Demise that got a Nissan commercial that did really well.
Was it a national?
Or? Yeah, national. Wow. Nissan yeah. commercial. And then it was like I would get these ASCAP reports and it would tell me like all the shows my stuff. And it was like hundreds of shows. And some of it's like reality TV. It's like you don't want to brag about it, but it still pays money.
Yep.
You know, and then there were some movies and.
But like TV, NCIS, Grey's Anatomy, Sons of Anarchy, Desperate Housewives, Boston Legal, Ugly Betty, Lucifer
is a newer one. Recently.
And Shameless is a more recent.
Shameless, I had two songs in. The music supervisor liked my stuff. That's awesome. Yeah, Sons of Anarchy.
Both of those are big shows right now. Sons of Anarchy is, yeah, big. I mean, they're all.
Yeah, Lucifer is the only one that I think is still going, but. Yeah, I wrote this song called Skies Falling, which ended up on Lucifer and a few other pretty big shows right away. And it was a real big production, you know, lots of foot stomps and claps and huge group vocals.
Yeah, it's great. It's a great song. I love that. Yeah. And then movies, too. I mean, obviously, like that happens, too. But ending up on a soundtrack for movies.
Yeah.
Different than a TV, just a TV show spot or something, right?
I've had less of those. I had in 2015, there was a movie called The Call with Halle Berry.
Yeah.
And they used like 45 seconds of one of my songs while this person was being kidnapped in the trunk of a car. And the kidnapper turns on the radio and this song of mine comes on. I forget what it was even called, but that was actually pretty cool.
Yeah. That's so wild. It's crazy.
That was cool.
Crazy experience. So again, I imagine though that when you, so 300 cuts, that's a ton. That's a lot.
It's a nice catalog. Release.
Yeah. But even still, it's going into a catalog of thousands of songs, thousands and thousands and thousands of songs. So to have your songs picked up, nice. I mean, you're doing something special to get that many hits.
And like I said, we were kind of, we were better at, I think, and you know, I'm sure some people would disagree with me and think I'm an asshole for saying this, but I think we were better at doing rock guitar music than anybody else at the time for that kind of thing.
In that world, yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this career is going well, and you moved to Grants Pass.
Mm-hmm.
You're in Ashland now, though. So
talent. Yeah.
You're in talent. Okay, so you moved to Grants Pass, and her family was based
there. Yeah, her family was based there. We moved to a house on Candler Street, sight unseen. We just kind of found it and said, okay, we'll take it. And I move here, and I know nobody. I mean, I know my brother-in-law, Byron, and my other brother-in-law, Gustavo, and my mother-in-law, and sister-in-law, and that's about it, you know. So I had lots of time, and plus, you know, I was like, it was pretty close to after 9/11, and you know, I kind of have dark skin, and I felt like back then Grants Pass was not quite the tolerant you know, place that it is now. So I felt kind of like scrutinized, you know, when I was here. So I stayed home and worked a lot. I worked out 20-hour days, just recording stuff, you know.
Okay.
And it was great because I got a lot done, and it paid for a house that I'm living in now, and allowed my kid to, you know, I was able to put food on the table doing what I loved, you know.
That's amazing. How long did you live here in Grants Pass?
I think we were here for, we moved out of Grants Pass in 2010, so I think we were here for like a good four or five years, maybe.
And what projects did you have going here?
None.
Okay, so you were just doing your own stuff.
Yeah, I had friends in Ashland who had a band called the Rogue Suspects.
Yep.
Who I would go sit in with, you know, when I wanted to play live every now and then. But other than that, and I thought at the time, I was like, I didn't really think I was going to be performing anymore. I thought, this is my gig, you know, recording stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, it turned out completely differently, but that was what I thought at the time. And I was at peace with it, you know? Mm-hmm.
So through doing the producing of your own stuff, you got to be pretty good at producing.
I did.
And at what point did you start producing for other people?
I got my first production gig. It was a guy named Kieran Devine when I moved to Ashland in 2009 or 08. And the word got around, and so I got to produce a lot of local people. And then more recently, I was doing a lot of work. There's a producer named Sylvia Massey
who's
an amazing producer who has a place in Ashland.
I'd love to get her on the podcast at some point. You should. I think she'd be a great.
She has this thing in a church, and she had an Hivve console in this church in Ashland that I used to do all my drum tracks. And, you know, she started sending me people that she didn't have time to produce.
Right.
So I got a lot of gigs that way, and some were just friends that I, word of mouth. I never advertised. I've still to this day have never looked for a producing gig in this area. They just come to me. So
yeah, we've made a name and found success in it.
Yeah. And, you know, most of the stuff ends up being really good. I think everybody's pretty happy with what I'm doing for them.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I mean,
I hope
it, that's why you keep getting more, right? Because the word gets out and people rave about it and refer to you. And,
the first thing they say is, when they call me is like, well, I hear you're not cheap.
That's good.
And I go, no, I'm not cheap. Sorry. But you know, I promise you it'll sound like a record.
Yeah. Yeah. You want cheap?
Yeah.
You've got a computer, right?
Exactly.
There you go. Go for it. Exactly. Yeah. Awesome. Now, so, okay. We ended up in Grants Pass. Mm-hmm. Was there anything else, any other interesting endeavors in when you were in LA or any other crazy things going on? Cause LA is a crazy place. I lived in LA for a couple of years and, my dad grew up down there. My dad actually worked at Wally Heider's recording studios for a bit.
Yeah.
And Studio C doing recording.
Nice.
He was an engineer there. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty sweet. So he saw a lot of people come through there and did, you know, recorded for like Henry Mancini and a bunch of voiceover work for like Mel Blanc and all kinds of crazy stuff. Right. Which those stories are fun, but, I was doing math when you were telling your stories, and I think that the years didn't line up quite right. It was a little bit before that he was in there.
Yeah, I was mostly there in the 90s and late last part of the 80s.
And we were up here at that point, by that point. But anyhow, yeah.
What, anything else in LA?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I got married and had a beautiful family, and, you know, I had a lot of friends, and... got sober a couple times and kind of got my shit together there, and then didn't, and then did, and got to see a lot of, got to play all the, you know, the whiskeys and the Viper rooms and the Troubadours, and so that was fun.
Yeah.
But you know, I mean, LA is like anywhere else, you know, the place is as good as the friends you have there, and I had a really nice group of friends that I miss now, but nothing career wise that kind of set me on that path for the TV stuff.
Yeah.
And that's what I was
awesome
doing.
You ever do any work with your dad?
My dad used to sit in with Cobalt Blue. We'd bring him up, him and this guy Lon Price, who played with Billy and the Beaters, would come up every show and do a couple songs.
Oh, that's awesome.
I've recorded vocals on some of my dad's creations.
Uh-huh.
He had a few songs that I sang on that were really cool.
That's awesome.
Very weird, like, echoey-ish stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's about it.
Okay. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
So you're in Oregon now. You've been recording your stuff. You start picking up projects with other people. Mm-hmm. When did you start getting into, I mean, other than just sitting in here and there, when did you start bands again? When did that happen?
So when I first moved to Ashland, you know, I did have a network of friends, like all the Rogue Suspects guys and that guy Dirk, who was my old friend from LA. And we started, there was a little restaurant / music venue called Tees back then, which was in Ashland. And they used to have these nights where singer-songwriters would come and play. And I think there were open mic nights or whatever. And I started doing those, and my band kind of got put together through just people sitting in. And one by one, I started putting this band together, not intending to, but we ended up creating Left, which is an acronym for last names. And it was just a great vehicle to do all the different songs that I've written over the years, you know.
That's great. Yeah, and we got to have you on our stage.
Yeah.
Briefly, you played a couple of songs for a fundraiser last summer.
Yeah. So I play with them. I mean, COVID kind of put the kibosh on a lot of stuff I was doing.
Yeah.
I mean, I lost a lot of gigs that year, but... And then my friend Alice DiMaselli and I was working on her album when Tom Petty passed away. Mm-hmm. And we had both talked about how much we love Tom Petty. And we were like, we should do a Tom Petty thing. And we put together this project called Petty Thievery that did really well, like right up until the pandemic. You know, we
booked
houses, and we started getting booked in Bend and Eugene, and had some great gigs booked when COVID hit.
Yeah.
Stuff.
So. And we got to have you guys on our stage for a few songs for that same fundraiser as Petty Thievery. So, man, that's a...
I mean, there's a guy who can use four chords pretty well.
Yeah, that's true. He's an incredible songwriter. Right?
He really is.
Okay, so Left starts up, and you start getting yourself back out there performing and realizing how much you missed it, I'm sure. This whole time you're writing, though.
I'm always writing.
You're always writing.
Stuff.
Yeah.
You know.
You ever do much touring?
The only touring I've done is with Gifthorse.
Okay.
And it was just mainly, I mean, we did South by Southwest, North by Northwest, but mainly we were doing... between Seattle and LA.
Okay.
Just up the coast. The
West Coast.
Up and down the West Coast. Yeah.
Yeah. Right on.
In a van with a bunch of guys.
It's a party. stories.
It was crazy. I mean, you know, I was married and sober during that time, so the other guys were having all the fun, but there's stories,
Yeah. How long have you been married?
I've been married 23 years.
Awesome.
24 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
And your kids?
One kid. Bowie. Who lives in Portland, and she's an amazing artist. She sings like a bird. Like she doesn't write, but I've recorded songs that I wrote that we recorded together, and she plays ukulele, and she's got an amazing voice. So she's a musician doesn't really play out. She's a little shy, I think. But she's been doing really well with her art. She's doing a lot of Etsy stuff and art fairs, and she's got a really distinctive, cool kind of style.
That's awesome. How old is she now?
She's 23.
23?
They are 23.
They're 23. Okay. And when they come down, you to visit? Do you ever play?
Yeah. Yeah. We'll sit down and jam.
Gig, so, gig
we've done a gig together. We opened for Jackie Green at the Rogue Theater once together, me and Bowie and Bob Evanuk actually.
Oh, okay, cool.
It was really cool. There's a video out there.
Ukulele and singing and...
Yeah, yeah.
So awesome, yeah.
That's
rewarding, being able to play with your child.
That's amazing. Yeah. I wish I had done more of it. I mean, my big regret is that I didn't have Bowie sing on more of the stuff I did for TV.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, there was high school and I was always slammed and... Hopefully, maybe it'll happen, you know.
Yeah.
There's no one I'd rather work with.
Oh, wow. That's beautiful. Yeah. Proud father. Mm-hmm. Can definitely tell. Okay, so let's see. So Left. Tell me about Left.
So Left.
What made you that project come together? Because you didn't have a band. You weren't.
Yeah. So I joke the bass player. Sorry, I'm not in the mic. The bass player, Greg Frederick, I always say it's his band, you know, they're my songs, because he does all the booking, and he's the one who kind of put it together.
Yeah.
But
Shout out to Greg. Yeah.
Hello, hey, hello, hey. Hello. Hi, world. Yes, welcome to Friday Night Live from the Hivve. How are you all tonight? That's our live studio audience welcoming you, saying hello. We're super stoked that you're here. If this is your first time, welcome. If you've been here before, you know how it works, all right? If please like, subscribe, share this stream out, start a watch party, all of those amazing things really help other people be able to participate in this event we're having tonight. If you enjoy what you're liking, leave a comment. We'll give that feedback to the artists as the show goes on, and we'll have some back and forth. It's going to be a great time. If you'd like to help out, go to thehivve.com/contribute, and we'll go ahead and post that link here shortly. And the suggested donation for the show tonight is $10, so we appreciate you being with us. If that works, if you can do that, it helps us keep nights like this going and these artists paid. So thank you very much. And without further ado, I'm going to welcome Mr. Bret Levick and Bob Avaniak.
Hey.
Thank you all.
I'm glad the applause sign is on.
How you feeling tonight, Bret?
I'm doing good. My stomach was upset, and I went downstairs to the G Street Bar and Grill and had some sushi, and I ate one little piece of ginger, and it went away.
It helped you. It did.
It was amazing. So this is an ad for ginger. Buy ginger. And pork belly.
They go together.
So we're going to be doing a lot of songs that span my I'm old, long career, and... The first one we're going to do is a song. I was in a band called Gifthorse in the late 90s. That it was a great band that lasted about 3 years. And we put out a really nice album that charted for 3 weeks. And we're going to do a song from that album called Little White Lie, which is a song that my wife throws back in my face all the time.
You mean this lady up there on the screen there?
Oh, wow.
She gave a shout out, said happy Friday show day.
Yeah, the one.
There you go.
That's her Lucille Ball look right there.
It's a great look.
Come out like a fist and pull me down, 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 down. We haven't played in like a year and a half, so
that's all.
This is we just popped our cherry.
Oh, woo!
So to speak.
Well, it's a beautiful night.
I mean, I've been kind of anxious about it, and not that I'm not super happy to be here now, but you know, you don't want to get up here in front of everybody and the people over there on the interwebs and look stupid.
Well, Kathy Kemper-Pell says happy Friday, and always thanks for the music. Nice. Welcome, Kathy.
Hey,
Heather.
Kathy.
Heather says, cool to see Bret on here tonight. Saw him open for Joanne Jett at Brit.
Oh, yeah,
and
Joan
Love,
Jett. That was super fun.
Love Sky is Falling, that I first heard on the show Lucifer.
Yep.
Boom.
Yeah, that one's such a production, we couldn't do it tonight, but that's a fun song if you have a chance to check it out.
One more shout out. We've got Cordial Cables actually in the house tonight. Mr. Mike Smith is here.
Hey, Mike.
Yeah.
Cordial is a sponsor of Live from the Hive. We rep all Cordial Cables on our stage and in our podcast studio. So thanks for being here. Thanks for our sponsorship. We appreciate it. Awesome.
Awesome.
All right, let's do some more music.
Yeah, what's next?
Only the Dead.
Oh, yeah, so I don't know. There's a guy named Frankie Hernandez that roams around these parts, and we've been writing together for 10 or 12 years, and we wrote this song together, and it was a hip-hop song I produced, but we do it a little differently. It's called Only the Dead Sleep Well. It's about Hitman. It's a, you know, my last job.
step up to the microphone. It ain't just stories that you tell. Only the dead sleep well. I can't remember a time I had a full night's rest without all the thumping and the bumping in my chest. The mud on my shoes made a trail through the living room, and the blood on my hand be like a sonic boom. Alerting anyone with a judging eyebrow to raise. The fool in my bed has seen some dark days and some visions of hell. Only the dead sleep well. Pills for my nerves, pills for my head, pills to get me up and get me to bed. And Lord help me if I ever, ever get them confused. But it ain't no thing, they ain't the worst thing I do. I think of all the times I've been out of control, with the scrapes on my knuckles, the scars on my soul. Make it harder to sell, only the dead sleep well. Do you think you could take me on? Step up to the microphone. It ain't just stories that you tell. Only the dead sleep well. But I ain't complaining that I had it so hard. Only a bitch blaming life for the foot of the sack yard. I never asked to be an ass kicking fiend or a fire for hire when the deal gets too mean. I do what I do, I done what I done. And at the end of the day, I ain't leaning on no one with nothing to sell. Only the dead sleep well. Do you think you can take me on? Step up to Bob. From the weight of my load, don't let your ego swell. Only the dead sleep well. Do you think you can take me on? Step up to the microphone. Ain't just the stories that you tell. Only the dead sleep well. So many words.
So good. So good. And got to give a shout out here. Running sound tonight, we've got Mr. Joe Dinkowitz with Middle Rogue Audio.
What's happening?
That's right. Miss Alice DiMaselli says, props to Joe D on sound.
Thank you, Alice.
Sounding good.
That's good to hear.
Yes. And Shanti also says, it sounds really, really great, Joe. So
sounds
I think
really Shanti. Good up here too.
Is Shanti trying to outdo Alice? I don't know. We'll see. Terry Croft says, music is good for the soul. Melba says, how fun to listen to you again. And we've got a watch party here with
mom.
Max.
Thanks,
and Vilma.
Oh, hey, Max, Vilma, and my parents.
That's awesome.
Fantastic. Hey, if you're watching, leave a comment. We'd love to reach out and make a connection and let Brett and
mom,
Bob know you guys are out there watching. Awesome.
So, hey, thanks, Trevor and Joe and everybody at the Hivve for having us. This is, the vote of confidence, knowing that we hadn't played in so long and still letting us come here.
Yeah. Hey,
you guys got cojones. Hey.
Brett, you're one of my faves, man. You're one of my faves. I'm just blessed to have you up here.
We had such a good time on the interview. That was great. All right, here's a song. So, what happened is after Gifthorse dissolved, I got a solo deal with this label, and I was to write a certain amount of songs, an album's worth. And so they gave me a check. And instead of, back then you had to go to, it was like right on the cusp of where you had to go to a studio to pay $10,000 and get recorded like we did with Gifthorse. And I decided instead of doing that, I would buy some gear and try to learn how to do it myself. And it took me like 3 years to record three songs, or a year to record three songs, which they weren't super happy about, but it turned into a whole career writing for TV for me. So this was one of the three songs that I recorded, and it's called Good Enough.
I've got the wrong one. Technical difficulties here.
I think that's the one. Oh, your songs are in the wrong order.
I think these are actually called.
My fault.
These are actually artistic difficulties, right?
Yeah. We're not arguing.
We're good on the technical side right now.
Just tell me what key is it in. I'll kind of fake my way through it.
What's this? Good enough
right here, but that's a different. Hey, if you're out there, live studio audience, let's let them hear you. Let them hear you.
This is what happens after a year and a half of not playing.
I mean, this song has humor in it, so it should be entertaining.
In the cookie jar, Barbarella with a library car, and that's all I ever wanted. I am Pinocchio meets Peter Pan. Little skinny for the size of my hands. What would you ever want with me? If I put all the words I know together in a row, would I be good enough for you? All the words I never say, psychology tells you every day how brilliant you could be. How could you ask for any more? I
see. Saw the movie, never read the book. Half dyslexic from the substances I took. What would you ever want with me?
All coming back now.
Yeah, it is. You guys are darn warmed up, I'll tell you that. Terry says, streaming live on my TV, such a great Friday. Thank you all.
Hey, Terry.
Fantastic.
I'm going to change guitars, so.
Alice said, don't forget to tip these dudes. That's right. I also posted the link on both YouTube and Facebook, so you can check that out. And Jamie Smith said what Alice said. Thank you, Jamie. Jamie also happens to be here in the house. If you're in the house, you can jump on Facebook at any point and leave a comment for all those other people to see and make them jealous that you're here. Are you guys having a good time out here?
Yeah! I gotta say, man, it's good. I'm super glad that you all showed up. I mean, you guys, I don't know which way they are, the internet people.
The camera with the red.
But you guys, it would be really weird just singing to the, no, maybe it would be fun anyway. But it's super, even better to have you here.
Yeah.
And thanks for responding to the applause sign. I appreciate it. We didn't even have a warm-up comedian. This is another song off the Gifthorse album, and I think it's a pretty song, a pretty sad song, but it's a pretty song. It's called Dear No One. Just in case I forget the lyrics. I'm completely blind and I can't see anything that's on that album. Vibrating or anything? Okay. I'm just debating whether to put my reading glasses on.
As Mike said, only if you need to see. We won't judge you, Brett.
No, I look like Elvis Costello.
Yeah, right? They look good. Thank you.
how it's gonna be. Feed me something I can chew on. Show me something I can see. No one, 'cause this town's gonna stay. 'Cause I'm feeling so inspired in a manic kind of way. Before someone else takes it all away.
Thank you. It's a tough world.
That was a beautiful song. Matter of fact, Kara Brown said just that. Love this song. Beautiful. Another special lady who happens to be here as well, my mother, Joellen, in the house, says awesome time at the Hivve tonight with Bret Levick, loving every moment. It is a good night. Another shout out from the lady, Shanti, says, we wouldn't have known there was an applause sign. That was awesome.
We had to pay that guy extra. Yeah.
That's right. Fantastic, fantastic. Alice DiMaselli says, love this one. And Chad Michael Sweeley says, sounds great from here. Keep it up. Keep up the great tunes.
Thanks, Chad.
And one last one here. My amazing uncle, Howard Moreland, says, that one did make my big toe shoot up in my boot.
Well, at least something shot up.
I don't know what that means, but it sounds good.
Yeah, well, when you get up to that age, that's what shoots up, the toe in the boot. So, love you, Uncle. Sorry about that.
No, I love that.
Well, I guess while I'm on that topic, I better give a quick shout out to my wife and my two kids at home. Hey, boys, love ya.
Life without the wife and kids?
Not much. I didn't know what I was missing until I had it.
Until you're tied up in the basement.
There you go. Well, there's that too. That's a whole different story. What do we have next, Bret?
This is a song that I had a chance to write for a vampire show called True Blood. And don't, before you clap, it never made it in there, but it got on a lot of other shows. So. And it's a really cool song. I wrote it with a guy named Dirk Price, who lives here. You know Dirk, kick-ass guitar player.
Guitar player for the Rogue Suspects.
Who also was in a band I was in the 19... in Los Angeles.
Not the 19th century. That's not what you said, right? This is a vampire song, right?
This is a vampire song.
So it could be.
It might be. So this is a song called Barbed Wire Heart.
That's so good.
And I don't even need glasses for this one. This world, you hide in the night. You're a strange kind of girl. Your slow whiskey draw, your silvery glow. Set on the flame, fuel the flames down below. I need a barbed wire heart. Liquor store. I need a fat dime bag and a little bit more. I need a barbed wire heart that won't let you in. That'll keep us apart. I need a barbed wire heart. I stood in your yard by the dead willow tree. I was waiting for you. I was looking for me. The rush of my blood as you came into sight sailed off on the wind of a dark delta night.
I need a barbed wire heart, a whole liquor store. I need a fat dime bag and a little bit more. I need a barbed wire heart that won't let you in, that'll keep us apart. I need a barbed wire heart. Resist with magnets for eyes and your toxic and kiss with what's left of my will, with my bruises and scars. I'll try to shake loose, but I won't get too far. I need a barbed wire heart, liquor store. I need a fat dime bag and a little bit more. I need a barbed wire heart, won't let you in, that'll keep us apart. I need a barbed wire heart. I need a barbed wire heart.
That is one of my favorites. I love that song.
Thank
so
you.
Good.
Me too. Oh. And I know all the lyrics, so it's always fun.
Right? That's a good sign. That's a good sign. Deborah says, sorry I missed being there in person, loving the music.
Oh, hey, Deborah.
Hi, Deborah.
Hi, Deborah.
I know Deborah.
Mike Stevens says, I finally tuned in. Thanks for tuning up. It sounds great, y'all.
Mikey, I'm not always out of tune, dude.
Byron sends lots of heart emojis. Byron's supposed to be here tonight.
Where Love are you,
Byron,
bro?
My brother-in-law.
Yeah.
What's
There's
good
a seat
is he,
right there that's empty.
He was going to come with his kid, and we have this song that's totally like R-rated, so we're going to be able to play it tonight.
Oh.
So that's the good side of that.
Are you taking requests? Because Jacqueline says Coffee Queen.
Oh, yeah, that's in the set.
Oh, it's in the set.
Does that mean we have to do it right now? Or
no, you do you.
Out?
No, if you don't do it now, it means she's got to watch until later. So
yeah.
Let's do that.
Yeah, you got it. Jacqueline.
Oh,
no,
it's coming, Jacqueline.
Because I'm capoed, we're going to do Wish I Was Here.
Okay.
This is a song. They don't all have a story. I mean, I'm not gonna talk before every song. I don't need to calm my nerves and talk right now. No, this is a song called I Wish I Was Here. Sick angel, 'cause I'm being swallowed by the image machine. All my thanks to the corporate spokesman who gave me needs that I never could meet. They sold me dreams of love and sex, gold and never growing old. Held them slightly out of reach. My feet into solid ground, 'cause I'm drifting and I wanna come down. Now I've lost myself, and I wish I was here. I wish I was here. Tear apart these flimsy stitches, extract all the needles and the pins. Gonna take more just to hold me together than to break me down and build me again. Put my feet into solid ground, 'cause I'm drifting and I wanna come down. Now I've lost myself, I was here. I wish I was here. Wish I was here. I wish I was here. I wish I was here.
Thank you.
Wow.
I like singing that song.
I love that song. Thanks, that is bro. So good. That's that is so song. Good. Alice, Alice says, Bobby sounds great, bro.
Thanks, Alice.
love you. Another one of our favorites, Sarah Dion Brooks, who is also in the house tonight. Hi, Sarah. Sarah says, so good. And she's very right.
With exclamation points. And...
With the clappies. Eggs, I don't know. Lots of clapping hands. Those are clapping hands, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yep, she's clapping with all of the hands.
Thank you.
Alice has a request as well. Alice says, please play Better Than That at some point tonight.
That's in the set.
They're all in the set. From what I hear, he has about 6 hours worth of music to play tonight. So they're all there. Don't worry. They'll come out at some point.
You'll get home sometime this month.
That's right.
So Alice DiMaselli, we're working on an album for Alice that is going to be fantastic, and I can't wait till she drops that thing.
Rain sounds lovely.
Rain, yeah. As Joe says, the rain, it's like it's giving us that record effect.
Yeah, we're cutting off the vinyl, tonight.
It's like a vinyl effect for the live recording.
I don't have songs about rain, but Alice has a lot of them.
A lot of water songs.
Water songs are good.
Well, we could do some of the requests.
Byron also said Coffee Queen's his favorite gift horse song.
Okay, so Coffee Queen, this will be good because we can do better than that after that, and there's sequential stories. So Coffee Queen, when I met my wife, she was a barista, and I wrote the song Coffee Queen about her, and it's a very sexy song.
He said it's a very sexy song, everybody.
No, I don't. I was hoping she was going, woo!
Maybe she is.
Maybe. So we're not doing a whole lot of rock and roll as much as I had planned for, but, you know. Give the people what they want, you know. Is it Bread and Circus? Sits across the table, she drips into me like a caffeine IV. A coffee queen, waiting for some changes. Love and Nintendo is all that she needs. Everything feel all right. A
than a house blend, weaker than a kitten, hotter than hell. A coffee queen in my invisible limousine, playing with the windows, playing with the cell. Oh yeah. Sometimes I'm her angel. We stay awake all night long. Coffee queen and a lot of nicotine will make everything feel alright, 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 alright.
We're done with this. I'm going to tell you about the bridge that got cut out. She never forgave me for that. I'll play it for you. A coffee queen smoking all my cigarettes. She robbed me of my beauty rest, and I don't even mind.
Coffee queen. Coffee queen.
I'll play the bridge just as a late Mother's Day gift.
She says,
aww. I saw that. That's nice. Okay. This is the bridge. It's actually a cool bridge. I don't know why we decided to cut it out in the studio. And then I never taught it to my new bandmates. So anyway, so what would happen is it would get out of the section. And then here's the bridge. marriage. She would always find what's in between the lines. She's no fool, she's only killing time. Killing time. That was the bridge.
I know. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is how you milk two applause out of one song.
Yeah, we know how to milk it for all it's worth.
So that makes me think that what was the next one we're supposed to do? We should do something like upbeat.
Something upbeat?
Yeah, I have an idea. So yeah, one of the reasons that we don't do that is we have a song called Killing Time, and we usually segue it into some different pieces of other people's songs, but I don't want to get you sued. Are we allowed to do any of that, or Trev? Trev? So if I played an original and all of a sudden there was a piece of a non-original in it, would the FBI come down here and shut you down?
They might come, but only to watch.
Okay, good.
Yeah,
we borrowed it and gave it back.
Don't worry about those people. All right. That's what we brought Mike for. Mike will take care of them.
All right, good.
That's right.
This could be a sing along.
At least I hope they do. If the FBI is watching right now, you're welcome to come watch the show, though. We have a special seat reserved just for you.
Yes, we have the FBI section.
That's right, $10, please, at the door.
If anyone needs like a pee break or anything, we can stop for a minute, but otherwise we're just gonna keep playing because we haven't played in a year and a half. So. So this is a song called Killing Time, and it's kind of a whimsical, abstract kind of deal. You out of here? Love you, bro. Thank you for coming.
By Johnny.
Johnny Trujillo.
Johnny Trujillo in the house. Yeah. Woo. Another local legend.
You're missing the song I wrote about you. No, just kidding.
Ouch. That's like salt in the wound right there. You know, Brett, I'll have to keep you in mind because there's a comedy group out of Medford that's been trying to see if they can line something up, and if they need some stand-up, I'll let them know Bret Levick's your guy.
I've been working on the material for a while, yeah. No, stand-up comedy's fun, though. There's I just discovered this guy who's really mean named Anthony Jeselnik. Has anyone heard this guy? Okay.
Really
check
mean.
Him out when you get home. Okay. He's awesome.
Terrible person, probably.
Why is everything so quiet? This is the point in the show when the deaf people turn up their amps.
Here we go. This is a song called Killing Time. Is that how loud I was before?
Yep.
Okay. It feels really soft. That's not how loud I was before.
Whoa. The mute button. Watch the mute button.
Fresh off the train, like bright plastic flowers with psychedelic names. They could never be trusted, never be tamed. They sell off their mothers for a minute of fame.
Fame, 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 fame.
Sports with pay-per-view eyes. Suck on vitamins, cigarettes, buzzing like flies. Make my gray look silver, cause sometimes it's wise. Sit back and watch how they shrivel and die. I'm just killing time, wondering what to do about you, 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 yeah. I'm just killing time, wondering what to do about you. Gasoline queens with the serpentine legs, shining machines, try to break my stride as you slither by me, but with my eyes closed tight, it's you that I see. I'm just killing time, wondering what to do about you, 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 yeah. I'm just killing time, wondering what to do about you.
Try some time, hey, you just might.
dusty truck store to get your prescription filled. I was standing in line with Mr. Jimmy, and man, did he look pretty ill. We decided we're gonna get ourselves a soda. Cherry red, and I sang my song to Mr. Jimmy, and he said one word to me, and that was day. You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. Try some time, hey, you just might find to get what you need. You get what you need. You get what you need, what you need, what you need, what you need, what you need. Now you get what you need. Satellite girls are paid. I suck on vitamins, cigarettes buzzing like flies. Make my gray look silver, cause sometimes it's wise to back and watch others shrivel and die. I'm just killing time, wondering what to do about you. I'm just killing time.
Baba Vaniak on Dobro. That was beautiful.
Thank you.
Give Baba.
There's some tricky stuff going on up there.
Woo! That was what we call a cover sandwich.
Cover sandwich? I didn't feel like I wasted any time, though, just so you know. Felt like every minute was worth it right there.
As long as Mick doesn't come after you.
We have a question for our sponsor here. Miss Alice says to Cordial Cables USA, do you make stereo quarter inch cables?
So,
stereo. Yes, ma'am, they do.
So,
have your people call his people, or Joe, also known as Middle Rogue Audio, your Cordial Cables vendor.
I have a question.
Yeah. Yeah.
If we were going to take a two-minute break, would somebody be willing to talk about cables or something?
Yeah. Hey, you're going to take a two-minute break?
I just have to hit the, you know.
Yeah, you go do that thing. Mike, would you join us on stage for just a moment?
You can have my guitar if you want to play something.
Oh!
I don't have to hit anything. I'm just going to stay here.
Be back in 2 minutes. Don't go anywhere.
We don't you go anywhere. We're staying live. You had
even the Russian bots need to stay.
Just if you use his mic. Boom. Are we good? If you're home, give me a thumbs up. If you, Mr. Mike Smith, Cordial Cables USA. He also might look familiar because this guy performs everywhere. Mr. J, he's got it all going on. Actually, you performed on that stage about a year and a half ago.
Was it right here? February 8th of last year.
Right before the storm hit.
Yeah, no doubt. Dang. Stay here and you can accompany Bob if you want to.
Yeah, a little background, riffing. Yeah. So Mike.
Yes.
Say hello to the people.
Hello, people. Mike Smith from Cordial Cables. Thanks.
Hey, Cordial, Mike.
This is our commercial, our Cordial Cables commercial.
We were not prepared, but that's okay.
Yes. You sponsor us here for the live shows, but also are a sponsor of our podcast, Deep Dive from the Hive.
Yeah.
So thank you very much. Thanks. We appreciate all of the love that Cordial has to give. Yeah.
You guys are doing a great job with these shows. Where you've come from since we recorded our show in February, if we went back and watched that one with me and Krister Axel, it would be way different than what you're doing now. So you've come so far with all the cameras and the switching and everything. It's really cool.
Awesome. Thank you so much. So you haven't gone, like, typically you would be on a circuit right now going and hitting all the shows, right?
Yeah, normally.
Yeah, and that's not happening right now. So what is going on in the music world? Like, you know, what is NAMM doing something online? What's happening? What happens there?
You know, slowly coming back to life. We have 125 artists and industry partners across the country. And we're seeing a lot of stuff go on the East Coast and in the South, and it's slowly filtering this way with live shows and events. But, you know, for the last year and a half, it's been all about the online stuff and the streaming stuff. As some of you may know, the market was ridiculously up last year, the music market, in a lot of ways, because people were locking down and doing live streams and podcasts like you guys are doing. So It's been a really interesting change from all the live shows. Everybody's coming out of their cocoons, and we predict anyway, what we're seeing is that people are just aching for live music, and they're going to get out and start.
Yeah.
That's what we see happening.
Love that. Love the live music. Again, thank you, Cordial Cables. Hey, I have a question for you, Bob. So are you we're getting requests here, man. Do you have a solo in up your sleeve? You got a slide solo up your sleeve there?
Oh, geez. I could come up with something.
I mean, I'm just saying, like, Jacqueline says, have Bob solo. And I can't not entertain that thought. Thank you, Mike. Cordial Cables USA, thank you so much.
You'd think that sitting in my room for like a year, I could come up with something, but. a song called the Shenandoah. Stephen Foster, that was way back 1800s, wrote this tune called Hard Times. Thank you.
Yeah. Bob Avaniak on the Dobro. Thank you so much. Let's welcome Bret Levick back to the stage, everybody. One, come on, let's go.
That's why I've been playing with this guy for, what,
10 years? 10 years, something like that. Seems a lot longer than that. It does
feel like longer. If you were to ask my son, that's a lifetime.
That is a lifetime. To me, it's a drop in the bucket.
It's getting to feel that way.
Alice's request.
Which one was that?
Better than that? Still remember that?
Yeah.
Nope.
So I have charts.
Alice says, yeah, Bob. So good. Annie McIntyre says, gorgeous, Bob. So great to hear you.
Oh, hey, Annie. Annie. I think she's on Orcas Island or Lopez? Orcas Island. Up in the San Juan Islands in Washington.
Fantastic. Ducky. Love the San Juans.
Beautiful up there.
I'm not going to lie, it's been tough this past year.
Another happy tune.
Oh, yeah. Right? Oh, thanks. The other one's this is a song that I wrote a long time ago called Better Than That, and it was the story of the fortunate time that I got dumped so I could meet the love of my life, my wife, Shanti. But I had to write this angry song before I moved on.
Wow, twofer.
Yeah. I'm wondering if I know the lyrics.
You're not angry enough anymore.
You can't do better, 'cause you're better than that. You could blame your addictions and other afflictions on me. All the fools that surround you would co-sign your stupidity. That's like a folk song.
That is beautiful. And I have to agree. Alice says, love the song so much. Thank you.
Yeah. Alice is like, she called me up one day and she said, I want to do a cover of it on my next album, which I happen to be helping her produce. So that was probably the biggest compliment a songwriter can get, you know.
I'm also getting a lesson here from Aaron Ortega. Evidently, I've been pronouncing Bob's last name horribly wrong and different every time.
Oh, look, it's phonetic.
He gave me the phonetic.
Wait, that's
Bob,
not,
how about out of the horse's
that's
mouth?
That's actually not right.
Yeah, Bob.
Evanook.
Evanook.
Evanook. Yeah.
Evanook.
It's not the nook, it's the nook.
It's the
He's
nook?
He's got the nook.
It's the nook?
That's actually not right.
Evanook? Evanook?
Right? Does anyone call you Evanook?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Call all kinds of stuff.
Tomato, tomato.
It's not the worst you've been called.
That's right. The Canadian way. Take off, eh? Okay. Jamie Smith says, we all did so much better and doing better now. Thanks, Brett, Bob, Trevor, Joe, Alan, Ron, Cordial, for making life better. Absolutely, Jamie. Thank you for all your support. Jamie's a big supporter of The Hivve, and we appreciate that. If you'd like to also support The Hivve, you sure can as well. Go to thehive.com/contribute, and every dollar matters. It all helps. It helps make all this possible. It helps us put some put money in the artists' pockets, and everyone could use a little bit of that right now, right?
Seriously? I don't know how much of the venue the people online can see, but this place is fantastic.
Oh, wow.
No, it really is.
Thanks, man.
Thank you.
I feel like I'm going to walk out into the East Village.
Wow.
Okay, that's amazing. So you just made my whole week or month.
Wow.
Wow, yeah.
I just call him like I see him.
Thank you so much. That's a huge, huge compliment.
So we had something else planned next. Well, we have some good stuff for you tonight. We have a song that I wrote that Bob sings much better than me that he's going to sing.
I am?
But yeah. But before that, we're going to do a song that I had on a show called Shameless that is called I Did It For You. And it's the story of how a person handled a recession in a bad way. Chance to say goodbye. Now it looks as though we're running out of time. By now you've probably seen me on the news. Oh, it might have been stupid, but I did it for you. It's not like I'm a klepto or a petty thief, but I never got the chance to be all that I could be. And I could only leave you with the truth. Oh, it might have been stupid, but I did it for you. Now I'm stumbling down an alley with somebody else's gun, and I'm thinking to myself, oh my God, what have I done? Crooked lines for troubled times, there's nothing left to lose. It might have been stupid, but I did it for you. Bear to see you go without, so I came up with a plan that would turn it all around. But I can only do what I can do. Oh, it might have been stupid, but I did it for you. Now I'm stumbling down an alley with somebody else's gun, and I'm thinking to myself, oh my God, what have I done? For the takers, not the beggars or the fools. It might have been stupid, but I did it for you. Another day, I probably would have handled things a different way. And as I lay here on the sidewalk turning blue, oh, it might have been stupid, but I did it for you. Now I'm stumbling down an alley with somebody else's gun, and I'm thinking to myself, oh my God, what have I done? Description and the dogs, they got my shoe. It might have been stupid, but I did it for you. Now I'm stumbling down an alley with somebody else's gun, and I'm thinking to myself, oh my God, what have I done? A crooked lies for troubled times, there's nothing left to lose. It might have been stupid, but I did it for you. Stupid, but I did it for you.
Yeah.
Woo!
Obviously, that one didn't happen to me.
I think Kurt Kessler said it best. Says, kind of an upbeat but shady love song.
It is.
And this is a meaningful one here. Bowie says, my favorite song.
Oh, that's my kid.
She also says, fantastic. Hi, Bowie.
Thank you, Boo.
Glad you're able to join us tonight. Bowie is someone special to you, right, Brett?
Bowie is my kid.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Bowie was born with a naturally good voice. Like, I work hard for all my notes. This person here can sing naturally.
Bowie, we'd love to have you come down and join your pops on stage sometime. That'd be amazing.
The other one that was on that same show, I think, right? That makes sense.
Which show? I wasn't paying attention. I was just over here.
To describe you. And I'm going to dedicate this one to my lovely wife, Shanti. It's called Words to Describe You. One, two, three. Just fall flat. I got words that drop just like a rock on a pile of broken glass. I got words that walk on eggshells, words that pack a punch. I got words I mispronounce when I get a little drunk. I got words of love and kindness, put a kiss right on your heart. I got words that melt away just like a billion little stars. But my tongue, it's tight whenever you come to mind, 'cause I ain't got the words to describe you. I got words to walk on eggshell, words to pack a punch. I got words I misplaced.
Real verse.
I got words that take the blame and others that deflect. I got words that gently disagree when I mean no disrespect. I got words that disappear the moment that they're spoken. Got words so insincere they'll leave you tantalized and broken. But our knees get so weak when I hold and speak, 'cause I can't find the words to describe you. With your subtle iridescence, trying to captivate your essence is wasted time, so never mind. Though I've known you forever, for some reason I can never get a line on you. We'll be right back.
I send them into space to let you know I hate to go, but I won't be home too late. The words that say I love you keep floating around my head, but none can do you justice, so I hold you tight instead. It's my tongue, it gets tight whenever you come to mind, and I hate got the words to describe you. No, I can't find the words to describe you. I just ain't got the words to describe you.
Couple extra words.
Woo!
So, let's see.
I think you manifested that yourself. You said, I can't find the words to describe you. And then you lost them for a second there.
I made it happen. I was my own self-fulfilling prophecy.
Self-fulfilling prophecy right there. That's awesome.
I've been known to write a political song here and there, and some people like it, some people don't. And I try to make it my business not to give a shit.
as a true artist does.
So, this is one of them.
You're the one with the microphone tonight.
Yeah. Well, so are you. I mean, you could shut me
while he's drinking his beer there. I just have to tell you all, if you haven't watched or checked out the podcast with Bret, we recorded that earlier this week and put it out. You can check it out on our YouTube channel and wherever you listen to podcasts. But I have to say, I had a great time with that interview. It was amazing hearing all the stories. And Bret is truly like a music renaissance man and has been all over the place and done all kinds of interesting, amazing things. So you should check out the podcast.
That was
it's
so much
great.
Fun.
Yeah. Thanks for doing that.
That was like a retrospective of my life. Like I could die tomorrow and it would be all buttoned up.
Don't do that.
I'll try, but I mean, how much control do we really have? All right. The song is called Carmelade. It's a word I invented. Now it's time you paid back.
stuck in your throat, come live.
Nightmarish.
So what do we have? Kara Brown says this song is awesome.
Oh, thanks. You said that. Oh, hey, thanks, Kara.
Yeah. And Melba says, loving hearing you sing your songs again, darling. Your mom and dad. Oh. Hearts, thumbs up, like prayer hands, thanks, all kinds of stuff. There's just so many emojis going on there.
Really?
Yeah.
That's a reedy song.
Alice says, great tune. Stoked you're playing it.
Hey, Alice. Children of the children, really?
Mike Stevens says, listening in the life of Riley Studio sounds great.
The life of Riley Studio. What does that mean?
I don't know, but I thought it you know, rolled off the tongue, so.
It does.
It's great.
I love you, Mike.
It does sound like we might end up with a Bret Bowie show at some time, because it's gonna happen. She says, "Ah, thanks, that'd be awesome. I'd love to." And then Shanti says, "That would be amazing. Please make it happen. Music booking gods."
They haven't figured out I'm the one who makes the phone calls.
Yes.
No, Bowie and I and Bob opened for Jackie Greene at the Rogue Theater some years back.
That's awesome.
That was really fun.
That was totally fun.
Yeah.
Wait, he strummed one chord and you're like, oh, that one, really? You knew exactly what he like strummed a chord talking, and you knew the song?
We were talking about this one. So there's a dude that I've known for a long time, a good friend of mine named Fred Lessman, and we wrote a lot of songs together. And one of them is this one called Children of the Children, which was probably the last one we wrote together. I don't know, a year or two ago. It's definitely one I need to put my glasses on for, and I was kind of into not doing that, but.
Costello's back.
This won't be my music video, I guess.
It's kind of like it's the more of the feel-good political song after that last one, you know.
Okay, if you say so.
Sort of.
Is there such a thing?
Have I written a feel-good song? One time I was dared to write a happy song many years ago, and I did, and that was it. And I went back to my thing.
Get that out of your system.
Music to slit your wrist to.
Comedy Central's calling, Bret. Comedy Central's calling.
Let me just make sure this whole thing works. All right, we'll try this.
I'm glad it's a really nice
I think
song.
No matter where you fall politically, you care about your children. Hopefully. starts crumbling like they always have before. Orwell had it figured out in 1984. There's fire on the mountain, there's ashes on the shore, there's a crack in our foundation that's gonna reach the shore. And you old man call the shots, you always want more. You're calling in your markers with weapons made for war, but it's the children of your children you should be frightened for. Well, we live by all your rules that never have been fair. They're meant to keep us safe. There's danger in the air. This land was meant to feed us. There's poison in the dirt. So we scour the scraps as the sun burns through our shirts, while the fruits of your mutations are seeping through our pores, and the rooftops of our buildings come crumbling to the shores. It's the children of our children we should be frightened for. All of our sympathy for those we never met, who knew that common sense was something we'd forget. You split us into tribes and bait us into feuds, so we crawl into our bubbles with those who share views. And the bad news keeps coming. We lock all of our doors. We talk with our machines, not in person anymore. It's the children of our children we should be frightened for. Hey!
Wow.
I mean, the sentiment's good.
All right. So.
Wow.
I think it's late. We're going to do. Should we do our closing number? Or what do you want us to do?
Brett, you have.
What's in the contract? I didn't sign it. Bob signed it. I don't know.
You fulfilled the contract and then some. Let's just put it that way. That's right.
Let's see what's left. I've got so many more songs, but I think that everybody wants to go to bed.
Alice says, you guys are going to give the mental health hotline number at the end of the night, right, Trev? Pull us out. Pull us. Hey, pull up. Pull up.
Is there anything that we really want to do?
Joe says, love this song. Anne also says, love this song. We all need to hear these words.
Thank you. Yeah, it's the words. I mean, you know.
So did I hear you right? This is it? This is the last one?
Is that okay?
Yeah, it's okay. Oh, yeah. No, you've given us
a
full night. You gave us a full night.
I felt like, I'm fine. But I look out into the crowd and it's thinning out and everybody's...
We love it. We love you. Yeah, no.
Everyone wants to go home and snuggle.
We love you, Brett. Thank you so much for being here tonight.
It's been so much fun. Thank you, guys.
Let them know, you guys. Let's hear you. That's right. And if you're at home, let them know.
Thank you.
And Bob, thank you so much.
This fucking
my
guy.
Pleasure.
Amazing.
It's wonderful place to play.
All right. So, all right. Since there's no kids here. We have two for you.
Kids, if you're home watching this, earmuffs.
Exactly. Where's all my sound? Oh, the amp's off. That's
I think the amp called it a night.
Turn my amp off. Still not that loud. Oh, I know why.
The mute button.
It has been a while since you've been on stage, isn't it? All these pedals.
I've never used this particular one that does, I don't know what it does.
No, not that one.
It's pretty. It's got three lights instead of one. All right, we're going to do a comedy song, and then we'll do a fun love song, and then we're gonna go home. You guys don't mind if we swear, right?
Let it out. You earned it, man. You earned it.
Get us off the grid. I need money, fuck you money. For a soul sucking world that wants me dead. I need money, fuck you money. So I can drop out like we did in 68. Sit around and wait. Need a way to get the world off of my shoulders. And a way to put the sparkle in her eyes. To keep my feet from getting any colder.
on some fuck you money. Stashed underneath my bed, I need a way to get the world off of my shoulders. Song.
Shanti says more. More.
More money?
More. Just more of it all.
More of it all.
Byron also says more. Alice says bravo.
Thank you, Alice. Hey, I'm going to dedicate this one to Shanti. Yeah, I love my wife.
There she is.
She's a good lady.
She is. Thank you for loaning us Bret for the night, Shanti.
So, if you want to know why she's not here, it's kind of an embarrassing story, but it's just as embarrassing to her, to me, as it is to her. So, when this pandemic started, we got two puppies because we lost two dogs that we were really attached to. And we said, never again. And then all of a sudden I was like, but I need something to hold. And she was like, okay. And we found these two puppies that were at a rescue, and we brought them in. And then the pandemic hit, so we never like socialized them. They never went out. And so now we've never left him alone at the house yet. So I haven't seen my wife outside of my house in about a year and a half, basically. I don't even know if she exists outside of the house.
Schrodinger's wife.
But that we're figuring it out. We got one of those Furbos that throws them treats and has a little camera. And so we're working on all that. So she'll be at a show soon. But
Shanti, we love you. She says, I love you too. We're moving back to GP now that the Hivve is there, right? Yay, it's settled.
Hey,
bring the dogs.
I'd be down. Are there apartments in the Hivve anywhere?
Yeah, we'll put you up. The dogs are welcome too.
All right, sure. All right. This is a song called Look At You that, like I said, has done pretty well for me. And I think you'll hear why it's a good song. And everybody at the Hivve for having us.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you guys.
Thank you.
look at you. When you're looking at me, I like to look at you. When you watch TV, I like to look at you. 'Cause it's good for my soul and you're beautiful. I like to look at you. When the sun shines bright, I like to look at you. In the dead of night, I like to look at you.
Thank you all so much. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We love you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brett. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Thank you, Middle Rogue Audio.
Thanks, Trev.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Ron, Alan, for the camera work. Thank you, Mike, for being here with Cordial Cables USA. Thank you all in the house for being here. Woo!
Brett. Give it up one more time for Brett. It's been a while since he's heard an audience. And Bob.
And Bob.
Evnik. Just say it fast.
I wasn't going to mess it up again. Thank you all. We love you. Thanks for supporting your local music and beyond. Have a wonderful night, and we'll see you again soon. Peace out. That's just you standing there now. There we go.